صلى الله عليك يا مولاي يا أبا عبد الله صلى الله عليك يا مولاي يا أبا عبد الله يا رحمة الله الواسعة ويا باب نجاة الأمة يا غريب الغرباء يا مظلوم كربلاء السلام على من جعل الله الشفاء في تربته السلام على من الإجابة تحت قبته السلام على ساكن كربلاء فيا ليتنا ثم يا ليتنا كنا معكم سادتي يا سادتي فنفوز فوزا عظيما أما بعد قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد والذي بعثني بالحق نبيا إن الحسين بن علي في السماوات أعظم من ما هو في الأرض واسمه لمكتوب عن يمين الأرش إن الحسين مصباح الهدى وسفينة النجاة صدق الرسول وأمنا به نوروا مجالسكم بذكر محمد وآل محمد Over the last few nights, we have examined a number of perspectives or dimensions from the verse of the Quran where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, Ati'u Allah wa Ati'u Rasul wa Ulil Amri Minkum. Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu. Khitab towards the mu'mineen. Obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, obey the Rasul and obey the Ulil Amr. And we have established that the Ulil Amr is Ahlul Bayt. And we saw from this verse in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala introduces a hierarchy of authority or a chain of authority to whom obedience is compulsory. Having said this, you find that obedience is secondary in that before obedience there is a stage which is known as ma'rifah. And this is for this reason you find that Amir al-Mu'mineen states in his khutbah, which is recorded as the first khutbah in Nahj al-Balagha, where Amir al-Mu'mineen says, Awwaluddin ma'rifatuh. The first thing within the religion, the establishment or the foundation of this entire deen is the ma'rifah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To be cognizant of Allah, to have an understanding of Allah. And you will find that ulama in kalam make a difference and they distinguish between ilm and ma'rifah. Ehna, for this lecture, we will bypass the difference between ma'rifah and the ilm, and for the sake of simplicity. Ma'rifah in terms of gaining an understanding of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For Amir al-Mu'mineen says that the first foundation or the very foundation of this deen, if the deen is a structure, the establishment of this structure is built on the ma'rifah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to gain an understanding of Allah, because indeed you cannot submit to the rule of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You cannot be unconditionally obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala unless you have ma'rifah of Allah. How can you submit to a Lord who you are not even fully convinced of his existence? Therefore, you find the ilm is absolutely necessary as a starting point. As we said yesterday, Rasulullah says, "Talabul ilm faridatun ala kulli muslimin wa muslima." To seek ilm and to seek knowledge, particularly in issues of usuluddin. Today, enter Janabak, you live in a non-Muslim setting. You have diversity of people, Atlanta being diverse, multi-ethnic. You live and you share ideas with a number of people who may not subscribe to the same faith as you. And if you do come into dialogue, are we able to prove the existence of a God to a non-Muslim or to a non-believer in an eloquent, logical manner? Leave convincing somebody else. Am I able to convince myself on the existence of a God? Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Barakallah. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Am I able to convince myself that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala exists? Am I familiar with those verses of the Quran that speak about Tawheed? Am I familiar with those ahadith of Ahlul Bayt, over 255 years of hadith left behind for us from the time of Rasulullah to the time of Imam al-Askari? Am I familiar with these traditions? Have I recognized the Lord that I worship on a daily basis or no? For you find Amir al-Mu'mineen says that the establishment and the founding block of this structure known as deen, awwaluddin ma'rifatuh, ma'rifah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to understand the Lord that you are worshipping. Because total, unconditional submission towards this Lord cannot be actualized until and unless you are fully convinced of his existence to begin with. Logical, the way they say, for example, ulama of kalam, dalil naqli and dalil aqli. Even though everything within the naql encompasses the aql, you find that logical proofs, for example, outside the Quran, outside the hadith, are we able to come up with proofs that can establish the existence of Allah? Or are we in a situation that if we were to be exposed to another ideology, we would shatter, perhaps break like glass into 1,000 pieces that cannot be repaired? Insecurity in terms of ideology is a big disease that we suffer. Have you seen many times how you have, for example, and perhaps the sisters may forgive me, but how you have, for example, teenage girls who are suffering from inferiority complex. They are not confident about their looks. They're not confident about themselves. So they are always in a state of insecurity. This is an insecurity based on something that is maddi, something that is jismi. Then how about issues that are ma'anawi and related to deen? How many of us suffer from this ideological inferiority, insecurity? The basis of this insecurity is what? Because that founding block of ma'rifah and ilm when it comes to usuluddin khasatan is lacking within us. For therefore you find that Rasulullah tells us from the very first day, talabul ilm faridatun ala kulli muslimin wa muslima, bila shak, without any exception, without a doubt and without any exception of the gender, as we mentioned yesterday. Tayyib. For you find that studying usuluddin is absolutely important. You find proofs of establishing the existence of a God. And then you go into the Sifat Thubutiyah and Sifat Salbiyah, as the books of Usuluddin and Aqaid mention. Tayyib. This on one side. Therefore, in order to actualize the verse of the Quran where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ati'ullah wa ati'ur rasul wa ulil amri minkum, obedience to Allah, the Nabi and the Ahlul Bayt, the first step or the prerequisite to unconditional obedience, reaching the state of unconditional obedience is what? Ilm. Tayyib, ilm. And the ma'rifah in regards to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the same thing is required when it comes to Rasulullah and to the Ahlul Bayt, the A'immah. We need to have ma'rifah in regards to who is this Nabi that was sent to us by Allah. What is the reality of the Ahlul Bayt whom we are supposed to obey unconditionally? No other Nabi was commanded to build an ark such that his people would seek salvation from it. Yani, this was something exclusive, khas to Nabi Nuh. So when you hear the word ark, or you read the ark from within the Quran or within the hadith, you would find that the first thing, mubadara, the first thing that comes into your mind is the ark of Nabi Nuh, the ark of salvation of Nabi Nuh. And you find over here that Rasulullah is saying that my son Hussein is the ark of salvation. So you have the ark of Nabi Nuh, and then you have the ark of Imam al-Hussein, or Imam al-Hussein himself being an ark of salvation. Imam or Rasul selects every word precisely. If he is comparing Imam al-Hussein to the ark of Nabi Nuh, then there has to be a comparison between the two, like the way we said for Imam al-Hussein the day before when he compared Zuhair ibn al-Kain rahmatullah alayhi to Mu'min Ali Fir'aun, using that same trend. Why did Rasulullah compare between Imam al-Hussein and the ark of Nabi Nuh? If he makes a comparison between the two, there has to be similarities. You cannot make a comparison between two things if there are no similarities. This is illogical. Therefore, our talk being for tonight, understanding Imam al-Hussein by comparing him to the ark of Nabi Nuh as per the verses of the Quran and Hadith. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Ya Ali. First comparison. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, Inna Allah astafa Adam wa Nuhan wa Ali Ibrahim wa Ali Imran ala al-alamin. The first thing is the similarity. The first similarity is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran that He has selected and honored and revered Nabi Nuh on top of or above the rest of creation. For you find that Nabi Nuh is selected and appointed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be a guide for His community. And you find that Imam al-Hussein, same thing. The way we saw from the verse on the first night or the second night verse of Ahlul Bayt and the Ayatul Tathir and Fas'alu Ahla Dhikri in Kuntum La Ta'lamun. Just like the way Nabi Nuh was appointed by Allah to guide the community, you find that even Imam al-Hussein is appointed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Difference there is that Nabi Nuh is a Nabi and over here Imam al-Hussein is an Imam. But the commonality between the two is what? Regardless of whether you are an imam or a prophet, that appointment is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In fact, if you refer back to the history of all monotheistic religions, from the time of Nabi Adam till the time of Nabi Isa, every Nabi was appointed by Allah. When every Nabi left, the successor of that Nabi was also appointed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Successor of Adam was Sheth. Sheth was appointed by who? By Allah. Successor of Nabi Ibrahim, Ismail. He was a Nabi but also a successor, appointed by who? Allah. Successor of Nabi Musa, Harun, appointed by who? By Allah. Every Nabi's Khalif is appointed by Allah. Then why is the Khalif of Rasulullah an exception? Why should he be elected in an election and not appointed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Ta'ammul. This is one. Therefore, The first comparison or the first dimension of the comparison is that just like the way Nabi Nuh was selected and appointed by Allah, Imam al-Hussein is also selected and appointed by Allah. This is number one. Number two, second similarity between the two. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends salam on Nabi Nuh in the Quran. Surah As-Safat, Allah subhanahu, Surah As-Safat, verse 79. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Salamun ala Nuhin fil alameen. Peace be upon Nuh in the alameen. Yani for generations, for eternity, Salamun Nuh. Meaning what? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that I send my salams on Nuh in that I have honored and revered Nabi Nuh such that his dhikr will continue until eternity. That is why you come and you see all monotheistic religions, Abrahamic religions, whether they are from the Bani Israel or the followers of Nabi Isa, each one of them hold Nabi Nuh at the highest level of esteem. Salamun ala Nuh fil alameen. Similarly, just like the way Allah has revered and made the dhikr of Nabi Nuh to be eternal, and like the way Allah has sent salam on Nabi Nuh, Allah even within the Quran sends salam on Imam al-Hussein and Ahlul Bayt in general. Again, Surah As-Safat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Salamun ala Ali Yasin. Ajib. Go back to all the mufassirin of the Quran, regardless of whether they are Shia or non-Shia. Go and see the tafsir of the beginning of Surah Al-Yasin when Allah says, Yasin wal Quran al-Hakim, innaka lamina al-mursaleen. Mufassirin of the Quran say, Yasin is Rasulullah. And over here, Surah As-Safat, Allah is saying salam on the Al, on the family of Yasin, family of Rasulullah. Subhanallah. Like the way Allah sends salam on Nabi Nuh, He sends salam on Ahlul Bayt, and from Ahlul Bayt is Imam al-Hussein. Entire Muslim Ummah sends salam on Nabi Nuh by reading Surah As-Safat. Allah sent salam on Nabi Nuh. Malaika sent salam on Nabi Nuh. As per this verse, Salamun ala Nuh fil alameen. Just like the way the people send salam on Nabi Nuh, even when it comes to Imam al-Hussein, the Malaika send salam on Imam al-Hussein. Look at this hadith which is narrated by Imam al-Sadiq, Kamilu Ziyarat. Abu Basir narrates from Imam al-Sadiq where the Imam tells him, Wakkalallahu ta'ala 70,000 malik in the Qabr al-Hussein yusalluna alayh kullu yawm shi'than ghubaran ila ma sha Allah. Imam al-Sadiq says, Allah has appointed on the grave of Imam al-Hussein 70,000 angels who send salam on Imam al-Hussein until MashaAllah. MashaAllah, Ibn Qawlawayh says, until the dhuhur of Imam Sahib al-Amri wa al-Zaman. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. For you find like the way the Malaika send salam on Nabi Nuh, they are sending salam on Imam al-Hussein. Bas. Enter Janabak when you go to Karbala al-Muqaddas, know that it is not only you who is there in Karbala by the Dhari and under the Kubba. Together with you are thousands of Malaika sending salam on Imam al-Hussein. Only the Malaika, abadan la, even the Anbiya descend down on earth to send salam on Imam al-Hussein. Again, hadithun mu'tabar, kamilu ziyarat, Imam al-Sadiq narrates, he says, وَلَيْسَ نَبِي فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ إِلَّا يَسْأَلُونَ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى إِلَّا يَسْأَلُونَ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى أَنْ يَعْذِنَ لَهُمْ فِي زِيَارَةِ الْحُسَيْنِ فَفَوْجٌ يَنْزِلْ وَفَوْجٌ يَسْعَدْ. Imam al-Sadiq says there is not a single prophet in the heaven or in the earth except that that Nabi asks for permission from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to do the ziyarah of Sayyid al-Shuhada Aba Abdullah al-Hussein. Allahu Akbar. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد. شيء عجيب جدا. Who is this Hussein ibn Ali? The Anbiya come to do the ziyarah of Imam al-Hussein. يعني Adam is the Zair of Imam al-Hussein. Ibrahim the Zair. Yunus, Yusuf, Yaqub, Isa. They take honor in being the Zawar of Imam al-Hussein. Nabi Nuh is from the Zawar of Hussein. يعني that Nabi who Allah is sending salam on him in the Quran. That Nabi is coming to do salam to Imam al-Hussein. Salamun ala Nuh fil alameen. And over here Imam al-Sadiq says, Laysha nabi fis samawati wal ard illa yas'aluna Allah an ya'dhina lahu fi ziyarati al-Hussein. Imam al-Hussein, Sayyid al-Shuhada, Wilaya Ahlul Bayt, she adheem jiddan. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. For you find, just like the way Nabi Nuh was appointed by Allah and selected by Allah, same thing with Imam al-Hussein, selected and appointed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Like the way the Malaika send salam on Nabi Nuh and the people send salam on Nabi Nuh, you find that the Malaika and the people and the Anbiya send salam on Imam al-Hussein. This is number two. Number three, you ask the question, why did Nabi Nuh create an ark in the first place? Why did Nabi Nuh create build the Safina? Nabi Nuh created the Safina to protect the people from the Tufan, in that the disbelievers had been promised that if they do not take heed in the message of Nabi Nuh, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will send down a storm and a flood that will encompass the entire earth and everyone and everything that is not on the ark of Nabi Nuh shall perish. And hence Nabi Nuh built the Safina. Safina built why? Those who come and board on that ark will be saved from this tufan, floods in which they will perish. If you keep this in mind, Rasulullah, it's a hadith which is narrated in Sahih Tirmidhi as well. Rasulullah says that after me, or Rasulullah says the full hadith, that indeed the people of Bani Israel after the death of Nabi Musa were separated and divided into 71 sects. Due to internal differences between them, they got separated into 71 sects. And then he said the Christians after Nabi Isa was raised to the heavens, due to internal conflict and dispute, they split up into 72 sects. And Rasulullah then goes on to say, "Entum ayyuhal muslimun," after me, the Muslim Ummah will be split into 73 sects. No sect shall gain salvation except one. Now we need to find which is that sect, which is that ideological school of thought that if I adhere to it from the beginning to the end, it guarantees me victory. Yani, what Rasulullah is saying, Ya Muslimun, after my demise, there is going to be a tufan of misguidance. There is going to be storm after storm of deviation. Subhanallah. Storm after storm of deviation and misguidance. People shall perish except the one who boards that ark. Which ark? The ark of Imam al-Hussein. And haqqan, when you come and you look at the teachings just in regards to Tawheed, which other scholars may be able to deduce, scholars that have left and abandoned Ahlul Bayt, look at what their understanding of Tawheed is. Subhanallah. Hada innu Sahih Tirmidhi, there is a book where the Sahih Tirmidhi narration, which the greatest tragedy is that the hadith is attributed to Rasulullah, where he says that Rasulullah saw wal ayadu billah Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in his dream. Nabi saw Allah in his dream in the form of a young boy who was lying down on a couch wearing golden slippers. MashaAllah. Nabi, 23 years, gave his life fighting against shirk, proving to the people and teaching them that Allah is one, cannot be confined in a body. وَلَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ. 1,000 years later, in the books of the Muslimin, there are hadith that Allah has a body. Look through Islamic history. You come and you find 100 years later, books of Allah or the embodiment of Allah within the books of the Muslims. You look through the history of Imam As-Sadiq. Why did this group come out as the sect known as the Mujassama? Those who believed in the embodiment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ahibai, these people who came out did not come out with theories, yani, just from their pocket. La, they came out with theories and tried to prove the embodiment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala using the Quran. Not every theory that a person brings back to the Quran is correct. La, Quran is a book, needs to be understood in the right way. Allah has appointed those who are in charge of the correct interpretation of the book. For you find that Rasulullah says, 73 sheikhs after me, all of them are deviated except one. And over here, Imam Rasulullah says that Imam al-Hussein, Safinatun Najat, in this storm and this tufan of misguidance and deviation, you hang on to the Safina of Imam al-Hussein, you have hanged on to that Sirat al-Mustaqim. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala. This is number three. Number four, those people who did not board the Ark of Nabi Nuh. Nabi Nuh built an ark which is known as the Ark of Salvation. He invited the people to come on board the ark. Tayyib, they came. The people who didn't board this ark of salvation, what happened to them? Was there any other parallel or alternative to the ark or no? We are trying to understand the azama and the maqam of Imam al-Hussein using the Quran and drawing the analogy to Nabi Nuh, just like the way Rasul did in the hadith. Look what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran. Surah Al-Hud, verse number 42. The end part of verse 42. The verse goes on to say, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. وَنَادَ نُوحٌ إِبْنَهُ وَكَانَ فِي مَعْزِلٍ يَا بُنَيْ إِرْكَبْ مَعَنَا وَلَا تَكُنْ مَعَ الْكَافِرِينَ قَالَ سآوي إلى جبل يعصمني من الماء قال لا عاصم اليوم من أمر الله. Until the verse goes on to say فكان من المغرقين. Nabi Nuh called out to his son. What is used over here, where it was not the true son of Nabi Nuh, yani, there is kalam in this, is a discussion perhaps for another day. But Nabi Nuh called out to the son. He says, the son refused to board the ark of Nabi Nuh. Nabi Nuh said to him, Baba, not Baba, as in Baba from my side. He said, Baba, board the ark. The son says to him, no, I will not board the ark. وَكَانَ فِي مُؤْزَلٍ يَا بُنَيْ إِرْكَبْ مَعَنَا وَلَا تَكُنْ مِنَ مَعَ الْكَافِرِينَ. He's saying to him, don't be with the kuffar. Board the ark of salvation. He said, what? Kala sa'awi ila jabalin ya'simuni. He said that I will seek refuge in the mountain. The mountain will protect me. Yani what? This person is telling Nabi Nuh, you have found one means of salvation, and that is your ark. But I have an alternative to your ark. I have a substitute for your ark, and that is the mountain. Did he survive or no? La, he perished. Wa kana min al-kafirin. Meaning what? When Allah says that Imam al-Hussein is the safinatun najat, the ark of salvation, ya Muslimin, if you find a substitute to Imam al-Hussein, you will still perish in Jahannam wa bi'sa al-masir. Bishma. Verses are absolutely clear. For the true soul, the free soul that is searching for freedom and searching for truth without being shackled to the confines of culture and politics. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made the truth absolutely clear, black and white. When it comes to deen and aqaid, there is no gray area. Allah is arhamur rahimeen. Than to leave the entire creation in a gray area. He has separated for them the truth from falsehood. And at the end, la ikraha fid din. From those who want to believe, believe. Those who don't want to believe, there is no coercion in the deen. But just know that everybody is accountable on the day of judgment. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. For you find the similarities between Nabi Nuh and the Safina of Nabi Nuh and Imam al-Hussein himself being Safinatul Najat. Number one, both of them appointed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number two, Allah sends salam on both of them, including the malaika. Number three, that just like the way everyone who did not board the ark of Imam al-Hussein, who did not board the ark of Nabi Nuh perished. Same thing, the one who doesn't embrace Imam al-Hussein does not embrace Ahlul Bayt. Because over here, Rasulullah points out Imam al-Hussein as Safinat al-Najat. In another hadith, he says, مَثَلُ أَحْلَ بَيْتِ فِيكُمْ كَمَثَلِ سَفِينَةِ النُّوحِ مَنْ رَكِبَهَا نَجَى وَمَنْ تَخَلَّفَ أَنْهَا غَرَكْ وَهَلَكْ. The similitude of the Ahlul Bayt, of my Ahlul Bayt, is like that of the Ark of Nabi Nuh. Those who board it seek salvation and success, and those who don't perish. And she was the hadith mutawatir by both schools or in both schools of thought. Ala kulli. The next similarity between the situation of Nabi Nuh and the situation of Nabi Nuh and Imam al-Hussein. You find that if you were to read the history of Nabi Nuh for the 950 years that he lived as a Nabi and lived a total of 2,500 years, you find that Nabi Nuh was heavily persecuted and physically assaulted, such that when he would invite the people towards the kalam of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they would beat him up to the extent that he would be bleeding from his ears. How did they treat Imam al-Hussein? Same way. Ba'ad. I don't want to begin the maqtal right now, but Allama Tustari mentions from all the injuries inflicted on Imam al-Hussein, he was stabbed 114 times with the sword only. Yani the amount of sword wounds that were on his body, 114. Yeah, subhanallah, do not think anything in this alam al-takween happens by chance. It's not a coincidence. There are 114 surahs in the Quran, or Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim is mentioned 114. And this is outside all the spear wounds and arrows that were shot at the Imam. For you find the other similarity between Nabi Nuh and Imam al-Hussein. In that, like the way Nabi Nuh was persecuted and physically assaulted, you find Imam al-Hussein same, but the madlumiyah of Imam al-Hussein was more than Nabi Nuh. This is another. The last similarity, and then inshallah, we move to the masaib. last similarity in that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, the same Surah Al-Hud, if you read the verses before this, 42, so from 38 to 42 if you read the verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that a lot of the people or majority of the people refuse to believe in the Risala of Nabi Nuh except a few. Yani minimum number of people boarded the ark of Nabi Nuh. As per the hadith of Ahlul Bayt, outside the animals that came in pairs, there were only 88 people who believed in the Risala of Nabi Nuh. Ya subhanallah. Same thing you see with Imam al-Hussein. There were only 72 men who believed. History repeats itself and we are obligated to take lessons from it. Back in that time, thousands of years before Rasulullah, 88 people boarded the Ark of Salvation. 61 AH with Imam al-Hussein, 72 people boarded that Ark of Salvation. The question lies, even when you come and you see Akhiru Zaman with the Dhuhr of the 12th Imam, 313. Yani the top commanders. After that, there are tens and tens of thousands as per the hadith. But at the end of the day, it's that minority. For us to take lessons, understand the azamah and the greatness of the Imam that you are coming to mourn. And the greatness of that Imam whom you are supposed to seek inspiration from, inshallah. Those people who understood the Imam, they fell in love with the Imam, which drove them towards unconditional obedience. And one such example was the companion of Imam al-Hussein by the name of Abbas ibn Shabib al-Shakiri. Today, Masaib will be Masaib of Abbas. This companion Jalil from the tribe of Bani Shakir. Antum Ahibba'i, just like you are a tribe and you are a community over here. How should your iman and your aqidah be? Amirul Mu'mineen in the Battle of Siffin says about Abbas and the tribe of Bani Shakir. He said, Law iddat or law kumilat. Iddat Bani Shakir alf rajulan, to paraphrase, La ubidullah haqqa ibadih. If there were 1,000 people from the tribe of Bani Shakir who had the same akidah as Abbas, Allah would be worshipped on earth the way He deserves to be worshipped. Men who were staunch in their akidah, rooted in ibadah with the highest level of akhlaq. Abbas is that person who we seek inspiration from. The narrations mention that as soon as Muslim bin Aqil came to Kufa and was staying in the house of Mukhtar initially, you find Abbas was one of the first people to go and visit Muslim bin Aqil and give bay'ah to him, where he made that eternal statement and he said to Muslim bin Aqil, I speak for myself and I do not know what is in the heart of those Kufans who are around me. But as for me, ya Muslim, I pledge allegiance to you and your master in that I will protect you and defend you and fight against your enemies, even if I have to sacrifice myself and all this only to seek the pleasure of Allah. Awwaluddin ma'rifatullah, the way Amir al-Mu'mineen said. This is that Abbas who was part of the revolution in Kufa until the narrations mention that 17,000 people came and gave bay'ah to Muslim bin Aqil. This is when Nu'man ibn Bashir was the governor. When Muslim bin Aqil saw that a great number of people have given bay'ah and are willing to support Imam al-Hussein, he sends Abbas as a messenger. He writes a letter. Later, when you hear the Masaib of Abbas, and you look at the words that Abbas uttered, keep in your mind that if you want to be a messenger in the army of Imam, what level of Iman, Taqwa, and Wilaya you need to have. Muslim bin Aqil didn't select just anybody to become a messenger. La, he needed somebody who could confide in, somebody who will perform this task and accomplish the mission without spreading the secret or giving away the secret if he's caught in between. He selects Abbas and he writes a letter. Muslim bin Akil writes a letter. He says to Imam al-Hussein that the people over here are willing to support you in their thousands. Gives the letter to Abbas. Abbas goes with a servant from his family by the name of Shawdab from Kufa to Mecca. Abbas meets Imam al-Hussein in Kufa. As they are leaving Kufa on Yawm al-Tarwiyah, after that they find out that by the time Abbas was sent with the letter and by the time Imam decided to come towards Kufa, events had changed. Muslim bin Akil had been betrayed, treason, killed, left to hang, his dead corpse being dragged on the streets of Kufa. Allah with Hani bin Urwa. For you find that Abbas was this companion of Amirul Mu'mineen. The ulama of Rijal say, Hikana shuja'an khatiban abidan. Not only was he courageous, but he was eloquent in his speech. Eloquence comes from where? From ilm. Starting point again is ilm. Abidan. Abid. Traditionally, within the context of hadith, is used for someone who spends the entire night in a state or in a form of worship. You want to put your names in the army of the Imam? These are the characters that we need to have within us. The narrations mention that Abbas stood by the side of Imam al-Hussein throughout the ordeal of Karbala. He stood side by side with Imam al-Hussein on the Fajr of Ashura. He participated in all the three combats that had happened before the time of Dhuhr. He witnessed the death of Habib ibn Madahir. He witnessed the killing of Muslim ibn Awsajah and Zuhair ibn al-Qain and Abu Thumama and a number of the companions. After having recited Salatul Dhuhr behind the Imam, when a number of companions were killed and very few were remaining, Abbas ibn Shabib went to seek permission from Imam al-Hussein. He addressed Sayyid al-Shuhada by saying, Mawlaya ya Aba Abdullah, amma ba'ad wallah ma adhara ma amsa fi dhahril ard or ma amsa ala dhahril ard أحد أعز علي ولا أحب إلي منك. Abbas says to Imam al-Hussein, I swear to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that there isn't a man who I love and I respect and I revere on the face of this earth. There is no man more beloved to me than you. Abbas then goes on to tell the Imam, وَلَوْ كَدَّرْتُ أَنْ أَدْفَ عَنْكُمَ الزَّيْمِ وَالْقَتْلِ بِشَيْءٍ أَعَزَّ مِنْ نَفْسِي وَدَمِي لَفَعَلْتُ. Allah, Abbas is telling Imam al-Hussein at this point, if I could defend you with something more precious than my body and my blood, then I would do that for you, ya Imam al-Hussein. Yani Abbas is weeping that his life is only once, his body is only once, and there is nothing more that he can do to protect the Imam. The Imam then gives him his blessings. Abbas then says, Ashhadu anni ala hudaka wa huda abik. I bear witness that I am on your path and on the path of your father. The narration mentions that Abbas walked into the Maidan wearing a helmet and an armor, brandishing his sword. As soon as he walked into the battlefield, Rabi' al-Tamimi says that I recognized Abbas to be one of the courageous warriors who we had faced in the battle of Siffin. He had killed 1,000 of us, so I cried out to the army of Umar ibn Sa'ad, O people, do not come out against this man. فَإِنَّهُ أَسَدُ الْأُسُودِ. Indeed, he is the lion of lions and he shall devour us. Nobody challenge him. Nobody challenged him. Abbas stood in the middle of the battlefield, calling out towards the people of Omar ibn Sa'ad, saying, "Oh man, do you not have courage to face against me?" At this point, Omar ibn Sa'ad said, "Irshukuhum bil hijara min kulli janibin." Omar ibn Sa'ad said, "Pelt Abbas with stones from every direction." The Maqtal mentions 1,000 people surrounded Abbas. Each and every one of them began to throw stones on him. Allah, Allah, stones on his head, stones on his chest. But when they began to throw the stones, al-ajab, kullul ajab, what did Abbas do? The Maqtal narrates that he removed his helmet and he removed his armor. He threw it behind him and he charged against the enemies and in the directions of the stones that were pelted. Rabi At-Tamimi goes on to say that as Abbas did this, we did not expect this from Abbas, that he would throw his armor and run towards us. Fatarada aktharu min mi'atayn. Abbas was able to throw away and to push back more than 200 people. Rabi says, I shouted towards Abbas. I said to him, "Oh Abbas, do you not have a mind? Are you not intellectual? How is it that you dive into the ocean of war without an armor? Do you not feel pain when the enemies are throwing stones at you?" Allah, this is an answer and a message, risala, for all of you who are matamis for Imam al-Hussein. Do you know what Abbas said? Abbas replied back and he said, "Ma asab al-muhib fi tariqi habibihi sahlan." Allah, Abbas said, the pain that a lover feels in the way of the one that he loves is very easy. Allah, Allah. But Abbas is saying to the people, even if you throw stones at me, the pain for me is a bliss because I am incurring it in the way of my Mawla. The narration mentions he attacked thousands of hundreds of people with his sword, killing 85 of them until they were not able to come close to him. They regrouped for a second time. They attacked him from every direction. One would hit him with an arrow. Another one would stab him with a sword until another one came and pierced him with a spear. The narration mentions the spear entered from the side of Abbas and came out from behind. Allah, Allah, Abbas ibn Shabib fell to the ground. As he fell to the ground, he sent his final salams to Mawla. At this point, Umar ibn Sa'ad said, "Shoot the arrows at this man from every direction." People started raining arrows on Abbas. An arrow pierced his forehead, another one his ear, another one his chest. As Abbas fell down to the ground, he was struggling to take his final breaths. The Maqtal mentions that one of the person from the Lu'ana came and he came to behead Abbas on the plains of Karbala. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Ya Abbas, you have gone up to the heavens. You are with Rasulullah. But come the time of Asr, this is Imam al-Hussein surrounded by the enemies. Somebody attacking him with a spear. Somebody attacking him with an arrow. Where are you, Abbas? Wake up from your sleep and help the Imam of your time. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Wa la'anatullahi ala a'da'a li Muhammad min al-awwalina wal-akhirin ila qiyami yawmiddin. Matam Hussein.